Hi, thank you very much. And it's my absolute pleasure to welcome you to the first session of the Roundtable on Lives in Public Service for CFR. While we gather people, let me just tell you a little bit about what we're doing and why. When people started talking about the supposed deep state in America a few years ago, I thought it was really silly and I laughed it all off, because it was obviously ridiculous because the concept meant something and it was just a term of abuse. When it sort of stuck around after a while and didn't get sort of laughed off, but sort of became a thing, and it started to get tarred with a lot of the elites more generally and a lot of establishment types, I got a little worried. And then when I saw actual purges and show trials start, when I saw the Vindmans and the Jovanoviches sort of hauled before the cameras and sort of blinking in the light from coming out from the subterranean depths of the professional technocracy and get abused for doing their jobs, I got really scared. And at that point, I assigned myself a new project. And that project was to be the Alan Lomax of the deep state. I decided to be a folklorist of gathering the voices of a dwindling, venerable community under great stress in the modern world. And so I started this thing called the Foreign Affairs Career Center, and I did a whole bunch of cool interviews, like the one you just read with Michèle Flournoy, for inclusion as sort of models for professional service to the youngins of the world. And the criteria for inclusion in this club were that the people had to be great professionals, they had to be great people, and they had to be willing to be honest when I asked them anything I wanted to ask them. Not therapy honest, but, you know, friend honest, like no bullshit. Sorry. And so we're now racking these up. There's one going up every month, and we decided to do a public live version with sort of follow-on discussions with some of these same heroic public servants, so that you all could get a chance to put that, to ask Ms. Wizard or Mr. Wizard whatever you wanted, and I get to continue the conversation. So that's why we're here with Michele today. Michele, as you all know, because you've all read the interview that we sent you, which was wonderfully detailed and honest and frank about her glorious career. Now we're going to follow up on that. Michele, you once told me a story about going to a funeral of a colleague that you thought would be sparsely attended, finding it quite populated, and having that be a revelation which sort of helped set you on a different path or an important path. Do you remember that story, and can you please tell it?
Well, first of all, I'm honored and a little anxious about being your guinea pig, Gideon, but I'm very happy to be here and share any insights that I can for those who are listening in. So I think I told you the story of Sean Bremley, who had been my special assistant at CSIS. He came with me and Kurt when we founded CNAS and was a plank holder there. He eventually became the director of studies there. He served in government with me. He helped start WestExec Advisors with me. He really was my partner in crime in all endeavors, and just an incredible leader, young leader in his own right. Very sadly, he was, he had developed a form of incurable cancer, and within a matter of weeks died just as he was entering his 40s. And so I knew he had a lot of friends and colleagues and so forth. So it wasn't that I expected a sparsely attended funeral, but I expected a normal sort of funeral. And I was asked to give the eulogy. And one of the things that was so striking to me about Sean was that even as a relatively, you know, he was still mid-career himself with many years ahead of him, he was always focused on mentoring and developing younger people. And he was brilliant at it. And so in the course of my eulogy, I paused and sort of looked out at the audience. And first of all, this was St. Columbus Church, and literally it was standing room only. There were probably 600-700 people. It was huge, packed sanctuary. And I said, you know, Sean was an amazing coach and mentor. How, raise your hand if at some point you were mentored or coached by Sean. And like two-thirds of the congregation raised their, hundreds and hundreds of people. And this guy was barely 40 years old, right? And it was such a, you know, it was a revelation in the sense that I think it made me realize that, you know, I'd been doing a lot of mentoring through my career, but you really don't have to be, you know, a senior gray-haired poobah to be a good mentor. You can start mentoring now. I've told my son who went to one of the service academies, there's some other kid from your high school who's dying to figure out how to get into a service academy. It's not too late, you know, early for you as a freshman to turn around and mentor that young student who's coming behind you. Like, it's never too early. And when I think about Sean's impact, even though it was his life was tragically cut short, the number of people he touched in profound ways, personally and professionally, because he focused on that, helping other people in their development and their journeys, it was remarkable for someone who had his life cut so short.
So you've been the beneficiary of a lot of those great mentors. One of the great lines from your interview is choose the boss, not the job, based on your experiences, because you've had good jobs with bad bosses that you didn't like and good bosses and jobs that wouldn't otherwise be seen as great, but that you loved. Yeah. The story I want you to tell now is the one of the delivery of the first QDR as an example of mentorship in action, in which you presented.
Yes. You have too good a memory. When we were doing the 1997 QDR, correspondingly, I was very pregnant with my first child. And I had a wonderful boss, Ted Warner, who is famous in his time in the Pentagon. He's now passed, but he was an incredible mentor of young people, and particularly notable at the time, a mentor of young women coming into the field. So he was a mentor to me. He was a mentor to Kath Hicks, now the deputy secretary. He was a mentor to Christine Warmoth, now the first female secretary of the Army. And the list goes on and on, like two or three generations. He was going to single-handedly try to, you know, cultivate a balanced and diverse talent pipeline all by himself. So wonderful boss. And so it was coming time to present the QDR, and you can imagine, you know, all of, you know, the secretary, the chairman, the chiefs, the combatant commands, the all of the undersecretaries, you know, the entire department leadership coming in to be briefed on the defense strategy and the QDR. And Ted, like a day before, says, why don't you do the briefing? Now, any assistant secretary in their right mind is going to want to stand up there and do the briefing. But Ted was like, no, I don't need any more FaceTime with all these guys. They know, you know, you, this will be a great opportunity for you. They need to discover you. So he puts me up on the stage, and I am so pregnant. my first son was born 6 months later, that the admiral that I was briefing from with the joint staff, he was my co-briefer, he kept sort of offering me a chair and trying to insist that I sit down. So I was making everybody very nervous by being up there, but it was just a wonderful example where someone said, you know, I could do this, but I don't need to do this. The more important thing is to give this young person an opportunity to shine and to be out there in front. And again, just a wonderful example of leadership and mentorship, in my view.
So this is actually great. Let me actually go from there to something I was going to touch on later. But, well, no, actually, I'm going to take what you said. The women you just mentioned,
yeah,
and you and I are all part of not just the same tribe, but the same sub-tribe, a venerable one called the civilian defense analyst, not a military professional, but a military adjacent professional with disciplines of its own, mm-hmm. You know, McNamara's WIDS kids on, etc. That tribe seems not even to be recognized by most people anymore. And I'm curious whether you think it has a future. When you and I were growing up and being trained, there were whole sets of role models and a distinct notion of what a civilian defense professional was in either foreign policy or national security or defense. There was a whole raft. And then the last several years, it's almost like there is no professionalism here. We can get a secretary, you know, we can bring principals in to the areas that used to be run by civilian defense professionals or foreign policy professionals. And we can put anybody in those jobs because there's no professionalism there. I was raised to think differently. Do you think that whole concept is now basically exploded?
I don't think it's exploded. I think the cadre and the valuing of real expertise and people who spend years and years building depth of expertise, building policy experience, building knowledge, that was sort of marginalized or just undervalued in the last administration. And so you had all kinds of folks who have very little defense background coming in, or you have senior military officers being put in traditionally civilian positions. I think you're seeing a course correction with the Biden administration. You look at the people that are filling in the leadership jobs, and every single one of them has, you know, real credentials, years and years of experience as a defense civilian. So I do think that was a bit of an aberration. But I would say that we can't just sort of rest on our laurels here. We have to do a better job of cultivating a talent pipeline that looks more like America. You know, that's really important in a democracy, really important if we're going to leverage all of the talent that's available, really important if we're going to have high performing organizations, because all of the business literature says more diverse decision-making teams make better decisions, better bottom line, better performance, et cetera. So I think that is a job. There's progress in some areas, evidence of a female deputy secretary, female secretary of the army, but we are not done. I mean, we are particularly not done. We're not done on the women side, and we're also not done, particularly not done with regard to people of color and ethnicity, because there the pipeline is not anywhere in what it needs to be. And that's a long process. I mean, when I think about, you know, you take Kath and Christine as examples, they started as interns in my office 30 years ago, right? And I'm not taking exclusive credit for them. They are their own incredibly talented people, but I'm saying it's literally a 30-year process to grow someone from a presidential management intern to a deputy secretary of defense. And we have not made that sort of investment in that in cultivating that diversity more broadly. And that's something we really need to do, I think. As a field.
I want to follow up on that in detail, because there's two stories there. One, a relative story, and one, an absolute story. The absolute story is what you're talking about, which is there's a long way to go. You look at the number line and you look forward and my God, there's a lot more to get to full inclusion, full equity, et cetera. But if you look the other direction, if you look either backwards from where we were, or if you look horizontally compared to other institutions in American society, I think the US military is a glorious example in the long run of professional meritocracy, inclusion, and diversity compared to any other sector of American professional life. I can't think of any other institution of that scale whose record in bringing the various sectors of American society together into careers open to talents in a single institution that you can trust and has really, I can't think of any other better than academia. So how do you account for where we've come and where we still have to go?
Okay, yes and no. So I agree. The military was probably the first major US institution that ended segregation and started really integrated seriously. And they've taken that very seriously. And when you look at the rank and file, it is a very diverse organization, and it certainly aspires to be a meritocracy. But where that argument falls down or is, you know, not what it, you know, it falls short is when you look at leadership ranks. When you move into the leadership ranks, general and flag officers, you do not have a fully representative leadership ranks. There's some kind of drop off that's happening for both women and for people of color when you get to leadership ranks. And so you can have I'd have to count the years, 20 plus years between the first Black chairman, Colin Powell, and the first Black service chief, C.Q. Brown. You know, more than 20 years, like what's going on there? You can have the fact that, you know, General Brown is mentioned when he entered the Air Force 30 plus years ago, 2% of pilots were people of color or Black or African-American. today, what percentage of pilots are African American? 2%. Where does the Air Force leadership come from? Pilots, I mean, and others, but predominantly. So, you know, you have these and strange, you know, statistics where if you look at the number of African Americans in the total of, you know, 40 plus four stars, the numbers go up and down. You have, you know, I don't have the numbers on top of my head, but they went as high as 7, you know, I think 10, 15 years ago, and now it's back down to 2. So, I mean, we have a real problem in terms of representation in the leadership ranks and the way in which people are being tracked and promoted and retained, and whether or not they're being retained and developed properly.
Okay, good. I'm going to have another follow-up on this because it's an important subject. I once sat next to former Senator Barbara Mikulski at some gala dinner, and making small talk, I asked her what she liked and didn't like about the Senate. And to my surprise, she launched into a thing about how much she loved the committee work, getting stuff done, passing a bill, making it through the system. And I looked at her and I was thinking to myself, what kind of person is this that actually enjoys Senate committee work? Oh my God, you're the same type of weirdo. You like bureaucratic reform and management. You've thought long and hard, not just about like the line of we need to do something better. What could an organization like DOD or the military services, broadly speaking, do to address the problems you're talking about? What specific bureaucratic reforms and policy changes could actually make a difference in this situation? Because I know you've thought about this type of thing a lot.
Yeah. So I think the first thing I hope that, you know, Secretary Austin, to his credit, has established a task force on this issue. And I hope that they are starting with a sort of baseline assessment, soup to nuts, from the earliest recruitment all the way through to, you know, career development, career paths, promotion, retention, leader promotion to general officer. So I hope they're doing that soup to nuts view, because the one other organization where I participated in something like this was the CIA, where they brought in an external panel to help them with diversity. So it was Vern Jordan, the wonderful, God bless him, you know, Madeleine Albright, Admiral Mullen, and myself and some staff. And the question was, they were recruiting perfectly diverse classes, you know, gender balanced, representative. And then fast forward 12, 13 years to, you know, a promotion, the point where you're considered for senior intelligence service, which is their equivalent of senior executive service, suddenly the numbers fell through the floor. You know, not enough women, not enough people of color. And the question is, what is happening in those first 13, 15 years? Why are people not coming up the ranks? That's the kind of work DOD has to do, because it's not one thing. There's going to be a recruiting issue, because we recruit where it's easy, as opposed to really working hard to recruit a fully diverse force. We too often, certain services tend to track people in certain specialties down the line. That's going to determine whether you really are competitive for promotion and ultimately for general officer. You have mentoring and sponsorship issues. If you have a mini-me culture of mentorship, like, oh, I'm going to find, if you're, you know, the dominant leader in the predominant, you know, majority leader in the military, you'll be a white man. And if you're taking a mini-me approach, you're going to find another young, you know, white male officer who reminds you of yourself and say, oh, he's so wonderful, I'm going to help him along. But if that's the dynamic of mentoring, and that senior man is not mentoring a woman or mentoring a person of color as well, then that becomes a barrier in terms. So there, and then you just, you know, there are just so many other points along the path. So you really have to take a systematic look, and then you have to go after it in a systematic way. And I do hope that's what the task force will be doing.
You've said to me, you said in the interview, that the bureaucracy works, it can work if the people at the top want to make it work in effect, and they have clear rules and they know what they're doing. And that the notion that it's all ungovernable and you can't do anything or get anything done is just wrong. So explain how you can make the building work.
First of all, you have to have some vision for what you want to do and a sense of priorities. It can't be everything is a priority, then you have no priorities, but some clear sense of where you're going to focus your time and bandwidth and energy. You've got to pick a team that is capable and then empower that team to go out and try to achieve the priorities and objectives you've set. And then you have to measure their progress. And you have to hold people accountable. You have to be willing to coach people, move people, replace people. You got to hold people accountable. But the key thing that I found that was kind of missing, that I actually learned from my prior private sector experience and management consulting, was this issue of aligning incentives. When people behave the same way again and again, despite how the guidance changes, that tells me you've changed the guidance, but you haven't changed the incentive structure. And when you make relatively small tweaks to the incentive structure to align with your goals, it's amazing how quickly behavior will change. And I do have a story on this. My one favorite story, because it's very simple to understand, when I came into policy, we had a very exhausted sort of low morale staff, extremely mission focused, extremely service focused, but just exhausted. And so we decided what this team needed was some, you know, love and attention in the form of, we're going to actually invest in your professional development. And part of that is getting people to training, getting people to courses that have then set them up for promotion and all of this stuff. And so we brought all the supervisors in, said, we're going to emphasize training. The goal is everybody gets to the Office of Personnel Management, OPM standard of 2 weeks a year. And, you know, we're going to do this. Yes, ma'am. And then I waited. And I got like two training requests out of a, you know, 600 plus person organization. So, maybe I need to say it again. So next town hall, I'm there saying it again. Anyway, long story short, or short story long, I realized that people said, well, we're too busy. Haven't you heard there are two wars going on? That's my best person. I can't possibly lose them to training for 2 weeks. I don't know, have any way to cover them. You know, all these excuses. And I finally realized I had to align the incentives for the supervisors. And so I said, basically, if you're a supervisor and you do not get at least 80% of your staff to the required training this year, and we're very flexible about what the training is, that's for you and the employee to decide, but you got to get them to 2 weeks of training, you cannot get a 5 on your performance evaluation. And that is the kiss of death in the bureaucracy. Like if you don't have consistent 5s, that's like, you'll never make SES, you'll never get promoted. It's just disaster. I literally got hundreds of training requests within the weeks that followed because suddenly, okay, now it matters to me and my career. And so I'm gonna get it with the program. So you have to think through, how do you realign those incentives to change behavior?
Okay. Let me ask you one policy question before going into another little thing and then turning it over to our distinguished participants who will then murder board you as they wish. I've served with a lot of really smart people, as have you. And we've also watched as all of those administrations have done really dumb things, time and again and again. Why do smart people grouped together end up doing repeatedly dumb things like screwing up interventions, like screwing up policies, stuff that if you go back and look at it, you could say afterwards, well, of course you should have done this. Because all the people in the real time, it looks so easy after the fact and the mistakes look so obvious after the fact, but there are smart people going along and somehow things don't always work right. Why is our track record not better if bright people like Michèle Flournoy and her colleagues have been running things for the last 30 years? Why aren't we in a better place?
I don't think there's a single answer. I think there are lots of answers. I'll list a couple of them. One is, you know, you have to create a leadership climate where dissent is not punished. That people can speak up and say, even if they're the most junior person in the room, they can speak up and say, I'm not sure we're going in the right direction, or have we really thought about this or thought about that? I can't speak to prior administrations, but one of, I think, Barack Obama's greatest strengths in the Situation Room was he created that environment where even if you were the person, you know, the backbencher against the wall at the far end of the room, he saw you scowling, he was going to call you out and say, what do you think? And so he solicited dissent to make sure he had different points of view. So that's one thing. And then you contrast that with someone like Rumsfeld, when he was secretary, who literally fired general officers who didn't agree with him who raised questions about the Iraq war plan. A second thing is, I think we need kind of to give history a seat at the table. Like, there are countless times when, you know, we were trying to get our heads around a problem, and we would certainly get great assessment and analysis from the intelligence community, but we didn't have anyone who could really offer a historical perspective. For example, if you're going to shift to a counterinsurgency strategy, could you have an historian of counterinsurgency that could have come in and said, these are the ones that succeeded, and these were the conditions that allowed success. These are the ones that failed, and these are the conditions that led to failure. And you have that context to evaluate, okay, which of these, you know, groupings is what I'm considering doing in. That would have been extremely helpful to avoid some of those mistakes. So those are just a couple of ideas, and I'm sure there are many, many, many more.
I look forward to your support in your various capacities for funding for PhD programs for people studying counterinsurgency. I'm sure the Suamos crowd and other people will be very happy to take new people coming in to write those books. And John Noggle can train them up the wazoo. So let me, before turning you over to the piranhas, I ask you one question on a more personal note. I started this project partly to sort of seek out guidance from people who seem to have it more together than I did, and the hope that I could learn some lessons. And what I found was sort of depressing, because like people like you, you seem to have had an incredibly healthy, resilient psychological temperament throughout, leading you to do all the things you've done and to go through sort of psychologically unscathed and untroubled. I obviously not, you know, some freakish way, but the lessons learned, it's not like you don't seem able to tell me how to be you, because you seem to have been you throughout and just are like that. And my question to you is, what makes you so calm and resilient and preternaturally psychologically healthy that can allow you to have the kind of professional career you've had, do all the various personal stuff that you've done, and still be a nice, normal human being rather than some freakazoid? And it's an honest question.
Well, okay. I'm not always calm, cool, and collected, but I have my moments. But I think, you know, I think one thing is and without going into too much detail, I did have, there were some externalities in my life as a young person that were very challenging in my growing up. And, you know, loss of a parent, a divorce, some other things going on. And so I learned kind of survival and resilience and making my own way as an escape and survival mechanism really, really early. And that's one of the reasons why I did so well at school. School was the ticket out. School was the ticket to define, you know, control my own future. So I got well-trained the hard way early on. But then I think the other thing I would say is, and I wouldn't wish that on anybody to get that, right? But I would say, I think the other thing is I've always had been counseled to, you know, pay attention to the things that ground you. You know, for me, it's things like having some quiet time each day, whether it's to meditate or, you know, I am a person of faith, whether it's, you know, have other things in your life besides work, whether it's dear friends, whether it's spending time with your family, you know, whether it's a hobby or you know, working out or, you know, whatever it is. But even when you're at the max in those very challenging public service positions, try to, you know, you can't get the hour and a half workout, get the half hour workout. You know, you can't have 5 hours with your family, get 1 hour over dinner with your family, but like try to keep hold of the things that nourish you as a person and keep you centered and grounded and healthy.
Michele, Thank you very much. I am now going to open it to discussion, and we have a number of people here, and the moderator will tell us how to do that.
As a reminder, to ask a question, please click on the raise hand icon on your Zoom window. When you are called on, please accept the unmute now prompt, then proceed with your name and affiliation followed by your question.
Who wants to be the first to ask Michele Flournoy a question?
So we'll take our first question from Mary Boies.
Hello, and thank you both. I am not a member of this tribe, but I am a keen observer of this tribe, and I've always liked what I see. What worries me about the Pentagon is that if someone today came up with the idea of a Higgins boat, and we really needed it, I have no confidence that it would get built. Why is it that so many good people can work there and so few things seem to get done quickly, efficiently, and effectively? Thank you so much.
Mary, it's a great question, because it's really critical to adapting for the future environment that we're going to face in building up our capacity and our confidence to be able to deter aggression from a great power like a rising China in the future. We've got to be able to harness commercially, you know, cutting edge technologies, bring it in quickly and scale it and integrate it with our existing systems much more quickly than we're doing today. I think the reasons for that are many, but one of them is that we're working off of an acquisition approach that was really designed by Bob McNamara in the 1950s. And it was brought over from Ford Motor Company. It was a best practice at the time, but not so well suited to the digital age and a period of emerging, rapidly emerging new technologies. And so I think we have to, I think the practical solution is, you know, that approach may work for big complex systems like buying a building a nuclear submarine over years or a fleet of new aircraft. But if you're trying to integrate AI, or you're trying to integrate, you know, develop a new unmanned system quickly, you're going to have to take a different approach that emphasizes agile development and so forth, which goes back to my incentive piece, which is you actually have to take a portion of the acquisition corps who's only been taught to do, you know, the one way, and actually train them on a different approach to rapidly develop and integrate new technologies into programs. And then you have to incent them to do that. They have to have a higher risk profile. They have to know, be comfortable with the technology. They have to be able to be willing and have the top cover to disrupt existing programs to do that integration. So it takes training, incentivizing, and then promoting and making a career path for a subcadre of acquisition, kind of the green berets of the acquisition corps is what I'm advocating for. But it does take some systemic change to be able to go after that. And I do think, you know, I think this team is gonna try. You just had Secretary Austin make a very powerful statement about how we're talking the talk and not walking the walk. And the department, what about this challenge does the department not understand? We've got to move faster.
We'll take the next question from Beth Pond.
Okay, can you hear me? Okay, no, good. How long do you think it's going to take? Both the Department of Defense and the Department of State to recover from Trump?
I think it's going to take at least this first term, if not longer. I mean, some of it's going to take longer. So I do think that you're seeing a rebalancing already where career civilians are being brought into leadership discussions. They're being given important responsibilities. They're being made part of the team. And so that's very positive. But something that you can't recover overnight, even if you try, is the fact that if you look at the State Department, you had over 100 ambassador level rank foreign service professionals walk, vote with their feet, and leave during the Trump administration because they couldn't, they just couldn't stomach what was going on. Even you can't regrow that talent overnight. There's going to be a gap in the pipeline now. Maybe they can try to hire some of those folks back if they get authorization from Congress and they're willing, but it's going to take many years to create that next group of ambassadors that's ready to fill those empty shoes. So some of this you can create, you know, kind of course correct immediately, and other things will take, you know, probably 10, 20 years to regrow some of the human capital, most experienced human capital that you lost.
So there are no other questions at this time in the queue. So back to you, Gideon.
Okay. So I used to be much less cynical because I used to think that we were all sort of reasonably well-intentioned technocrats and that our problems were those of knowledge, not a sort of intention or capability. And that if we only could sort of figure out, as you said, which circumstances counterinsurgency worked in and which it didn't, then of course, once you had answers like that, you'd put them there. I wrote an entire dissertation about how you screwed up the ends of wars every single time. And in the time since I started that dissertation, we fought several different wars and interventions, and the worst mistakes have been made after I started writing my book saying all the things we've done were followed this way. So I'm no longer optimistic about the system yielding good outcomes, as I said, even when there are good people inside it and even when we have the knowledge. So I'm curious why you're still optimistic towards the end or later stages of your career when I've become so cynical.
You know, I guess if I'm going to get out of the bed in the morning, I have to believe that we're capable of learning from our mistakes. I would add to that list that we started with of why good people make bad decisions. You know, there is a certain, and I think Americans are more prone to it than maybe others, a certain confidence in our ability to change things and change conditions and change others. And I remember one of former Israeli defense minister that was visiting CNAS for a roundtable. It was Mr. Yalon. And we were talking about some, you know, horrific and perennial problem in the Middle East. And he said, you know, and how to solve it. And he said, the problem with you Americans, you think every problem can be solved. Some problems are insolvable and you just have to manage them. Now, you got to be careful. That can be an excuse for not dealing with something really important like the Israeli-Palestinian problem or whatever. But regularly around the situation room table, you'll have conversations about how do we change this country's strategic calculus? Or that country's perception of their interests. When you think about that, that's a really hard thing to do. So it's probably a flag to say, do we want to base our policy on being able to do that? Or do we need to accept that their interests and their calculus is what it is, but then, you know, alter their incentive structure, in terms of what they're going to do to pursue those interests or what range of things they will or won't try. A more humble approach, maybe.
You raise those questions in the situation, put it this way. When someone in the situation room says something like that, does some guy in the back or on the table or the side say, excuse me, that's probably never going to happen, so we should lower our sights to have a more successful policy, or will you be hounded out of the room for sort of being a defeatist?
I think it's a mix. Sometimes, you know, someone will question. Oftentimes, you know, an intelligence professional who knows the country inside out and knows their history will say, well, this is how they've looked at it for 200 years or something, but they'll stop short of the policy recommendation because they feel that's not their job. But it's kind of like, you can try, but, you know, for the last 200 years, this is pretty much how they viewed the world. So, but I do think that, again, back to the climate that's created, you need to be able to have those discussions, create a climate where someone can speak up and say, wait a minute, we're being way too hopeful, way too confident in what we're able to do. And maybe we need to, take an appetite suppressant before we define our objectives in this particular intervention or policy.
With that, we'll go to Bill Nash.
Thank you, Gideon. I appreciate you doing this. Michele, appreciate you getting on the hot seat and sharing your experience and wisdom with us.
Well, it's great to hear your voice, sir.
I'd like to go back to your professional development issue and you changing the incentive structure to get people to go to 2 weeks of training, et cetera, et cetera. It seems to me, and I would agree that the military model has some deficiencies and is turbulent at times in its model. But the matter of fact is that professional development is part of career progression.
Yes.
And so a leader has no choice but to send his best officers off to school because they're selected by a higher authority.
Yeah. It's an interesting model. I mean, maybe that is a great idea to look at whether that we should have something closer to that on the civilian side. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you, sir. Was that the end of your?
No, I just was going to say both the State Department and the civilian side of the Defense Department have a great deal of difficulty in institutionalizing.
Yes.
And too often, the slots that the military give to the civilian side are not necessarily, the people are not necessarily chosen for their future potential.
Right. So two comments on that. One is I do think it is the military's culture of, being a profession of arms, and being a profession means you have to have professional development and all of this sort of step-by-step skills building and leadership building is, it's a very unique thing. I do think some of that would be great to replicate on the civilian side. But if you do that, it has resource implications. So the military is resourced to have a rotation base, to have a training and education float, meaning at any one time, it's understood on the Hill that a certain thousands of military people will be in the schoolhouse, in training, doing something other than being available for operational tasks and deployment. And they resource them that way. We do not resource the civilian cadre in the State Department that way. There is no training float. So they may squeeze in an ambassador course, a quick course or a language course before they deploy off to their next job, but they are not resourced to do that. And that has implications. It means it means they literally don't have the additional people in the system to show up when the military, a defense college or a training exercise offers a place to the State Department. They're pulling someone out of an operational job to go do that. And that is not always going to be their highest priority. So I think I agree with you, but I think we have to recognize there are resource implications, and you've got to convince the Hill that they've got to invest more in the State Department without necessarily, without not just buying more people, but buying, that training and professional development time as well.
That is such a crucial point, because every time someone calls for a civilian surge, I just want to shake my head and goes crazy, because there's no giant pool of civilians to surge, because there isn't a whole pool of them like there is in the military.
So one of the tasks that Tom Nides and I had, Tom Nides in particular, and I tried to help on the OSD side, was finding civilians to surge to Afghanistan. And we got up to 1,000. And I remember at the end of that year, and all those people were coming out, the people turn to Tom's, okay, where's the next 1,000? And he's like, I'm out of Schlitz. There is no other 1,000 because they don't exist. They've never been resourced. They're not there. Nor have we trained and incented people in the Foreign Service to be expeditionary and operational and so forth. You know, that's a minority of the Foreign Service. So anyway, if you really want to take that on, you've got to address the politics of the color of money on the Hill. You know, voting for an extra defense dollar for many is a patriotic act. You know, on the conservative end of the spectrum, voting for more money for the State Department is, well, why are we building bureaucracy? I mean, literally, people sort of see a soldier in one way and a Foreign Service officer in another way, which is, you know, and doesn't make sense in my view, but we've got to make the case for why you need this capability. And it needs to be strong and it needs to be professional going forward.
Mina Boies, Cynthia Roberts, and Barnett Rubin are on the list. Mina, you're up next.
Thank you. Thank you, Gideon. And thank you, Michele. This is a very informative talk. The interview was also so instructive. I really enjoyed the questions, and I wanted to pick up on one and your answer. A question that Gideon asked you was an op-ed that says, here's what you should do on Syria tomorrow is worthless to policymakers. And you replied, it's not that helpful. And your answer about the importance of kind of looking long-term just, I think, addressed so well what academics do, right? What scholars do. Yet, I guess my question is about the public education process in foreign policy, because I know, I think many of us in this session could speak to getting queries regularly about wanting instant reactions about what is happening with the border crisis, refugee policy, what's going to happen with the withdrawal from Afghanistan. Queries often come from journalists, from students about kind of immediate results and or immediate action. And how do we communicate how do we balance that educational process, the kind of immediate term, immediate reaction, short term, long term? I guess as academics, policymakers, would welcome your thoughts.
Well, I think, it's a great question. If you're in the position of teaching young people, you know, I think when courses are able to introduce some kind of strategy or long-term planning exercise into the curriculum, so it's not just a current events course, but if it's like, okay, your job is to design the sort of grand strategy the strategy vis-a-vis China for the next 5 to 10 years, you know, how do you do that? I think those are the kinds of things you can integrate into an academic preparation that you know, gets people thinking longer term. I think on the think tank side, I used to always say, we all love to, you know, there are lots of people like to tweet or be, you know, the commentator on the news of the day, that the real value of think tanks is in developing the intellectual capital that the policymaker doesn't know they need yet, right? I mean, because when you're in the policy job, it's the tyranny of the inbox, it's the surviving your day, surviving your week, but where you're not spending a lot of time necessarily developing brilliant, great ideas for the long-term future. Those are going to come mostly from the outside or from what you brought in your intellectual suitcase and those around you. But that's a huge service that think tanks play. And too often they allow themselves to get sucked into the day-to-day at the expense of doing that more substantial intellectual capital development. The last thing I'll say, and this is something I'm trying to do in my own portfolio going forward, we spend a lot of time talking to each other, experts to experts. You know, I'm on I've done so many podcasts where it's a policy wonk talking to a policy wonk and there are a bunch of policy wonks listening. So I've been asked to do a podcast actually for a really smart lay audience, like consider your NPR listener, or your Freakonomics radio listener. And I've decided to do it because I really feel strongly about the point you're making, which is we have got to reach the American people and help have them understand why is this stuff important? Why should they care? And to bring them in with stories and people, you know, examples of people who they're like, wow, I've never heard of that person, but that was, wow, what a fascinating person. And I'm so interested now in learning more about policy question X. You know, so I just think we have to reach beyond our own circles and comfort zones to really try to engage people much more than we have been. It's very important going forward.
Cynthia Roberts.
Thank you, Gideon. Thank you, Michèle Flournoy, for doing this. So as a precursor to my question, I should say that thanks to the Council on Foreign Relations, I had a CFR fellowship year 2019 for the more advanced older scholars to go to Washington. And I spent that time in the Pentagon in the joint staff working in J5 in SDNP. And it was a choice I made exactly as you recommended, though I don't know you personally, in the sense of I picked the person and the shop, not just the idea of going to Washington, which I didn't need to do and my family thought I was crazy to do, but not having any young child responsibilities, I thought it was a great time. And it was. And it was exactly the right choice, exactly the right office, and a really tremendous experience. But it leads me to two questions for you. One is, it almost didn't happen because security clearances now take an infinity to occur. I'm a Russia specialist. I do some work now on China, but that wasn't the issue. It's just the bureaucracy. It takes forever. The physicists in my office had the same problem. So, you know, this has to be fixed and not enough attention is addressed to it. I was able to delay my year by a semester so it could still happen, but it almost didn't happen. And thanks to my university and to the council, we were able to do that. And it was an invaluable experience and I would recommend it to others, which leads to my real question, which is, I have the sense now that Washington has become more insular than ever. People always say we don't have enough academic experts on X, Y, and Z, but they never look beyond Washington. We have plenty of Russia experts. We have a lot of great China experts. We have fewer, but I know people like me are trying to build more expertise on nuclear issues. Some granting organizations have also been really instrumental in doing that at the graduate level. But I think I'm teaching one of the few undergraduate courses in this area. So the question is, why aren't people like you doing more to reach out beyond Washington and encourage sort of what we used to have when Gideon and I started graduate school? Our professors often worked in Washington. There was more engagement in the academic community, and now it's only think tanks. So I tell my graduate students, right, try and get a job at RAND or get a job at one of the great think tanks like your old think tank. And then maybe you can get into Washington, because from academe, it's not possible anymore. And I'm, by the way, not looking for a job. I'm happy as a professor, but I'm worried about my students feeling they all have to pile into Washington think tanks. And yeah. I'm also worried about policy. You're not getting that historical perspective. Mm-hmm. You're not getting the larger, longer term perspective. You're just getting, I think, a lot of what I read, even really good reports from Washington think tanks, are still very different from the academic analysis on the same issues.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot.
It's a really, no, two really good points. First of all, I mean, I think everybody on this call would be absolutely, in agreement with you about the need to overhaul and fix our security clearance system. It's become a huge barrier to talent, not only people like you who are coming in for fellowship tours, but also their ability to attract tech talent, which is becoming increasingly important. There has been a transfer of responsibility in this area. There is talk of reform and changing the fundamental approach, but the proof's in the pudding. You know, the question is it going, it's currently taking over a year for a lot of people. You know, that needs to come down to a matter of weeks to have it be effective. And given the modern tools of, you're probably going to learn more from an extensive Google and database search and real digital due diligence than you will today in today's day and age, going and interviewing the neighbors to the right and the left of the people who are being considered for position. So not that they're exclusive, but they're not, you know, there's a lot that can be done in the digital domain that will give you the bulk of the information you need to make a judgment about someone, as well as a few, you know, making telephone interviews or what have you. But to your point about, I agree we should be casting the net more widely. And I would love to see, you know, there used to be offices that we counted on to do that. So when Andy Marshall ran net assessment, he was basically a grant giving office that would fund, you know, fundamental, like really long-term strategic research on how the environment's changing, how different countries are evolving, how, you know, thinking about deterrence is changing. And it was a way to bring real academic expertise. I mean, if you went to his summer studies, it was a nice mix of policy and academia, but the academics were the majority and the policymakers were there to listen and learn. So I would like to see more of that happening. I agree, it's atrophied. I don't have a clear sense of why, except for maybe some of the funding for those programs drying up. But I would think that each agency would want to find the academics who are at the cutting edge of research in the areas that they're covering and find ways to tap into their work and to their talent. So I think it's a very good point.
Barney Rubin.
Thank you. Hi, Barney. Michele.
Hey, Barney.
As you know, there's a lot of discussion these days about the over-militarization of U.S. foreign and national security policy. And that means several different things. One of them is a disproportionate focus on military types of threats rather than on threats like climate change, pandemics, and so on. And another, something that I experienced personally during my time in government, is what I would say is an organizational cognitive bias against diplomacy or the peaceful resolution of disputes and in favor of military action, which I would summarize just saying that if you have a few meetings and you don't get anywhere with the negotiations, then the response is, well, you need more pressure, let's send more troops. If your military strategy is not doing well, then you say, well, the strategy is sound, but we need more troops. And you almost have to be apologetic about proposing negotiations. The presumption was they wouldn't work, whereas the military would be very gung-ho and difficult to challenge in their presumption that they would succeed. I just wonder what you think about those set of problems.
Well, again, I go first to your point about militarization of foreign policy. You know, there have been periods where you've had DOD on steroids and other agencies on civilian agencies on life support. And when you have that resource imbalance, you have, you know, trouble. You know, you have a three-legged stool that's, you know, diplomacy, defense, and development that's pretty lopsided. And you have trouble when you go to integrate, you know, for a whole of government strategy, it's kind of hard to do. It goes to, you know, that you don't have the civilian surge or the Congress won't fund your diplomatic footprint, but they'll fund, you know, a huge military footprint or what have you. So I do think that sort of rebalancing is important. And I think at least this administration is talking the talk on that. They are talking about a diplomacy first approach. They are asking for some substantial plus ups of resources for the State Department and USAID and others. There's downward pressure on the defense budget. So anyway, I think there's some rebalancing that is appropriate. In terms of the broader mindset, you know, I would love, CFR is a great venue for this. I would love, and you, Barney, personally are a great person to do some of this. I do think it's worth thinking about what lessons do we learn from interventions like Afghanistan and like Iraq. And I think one of the patterns that we see is the military intervention can reach certain objectives in terms of creating a more secure, stable environment. But you know, they can kind of get you to the, I don't know, 50-yard line, the 20-yard line, wherever you are, but they can't get you over, you know, the final line. That is a question of politics and diplomacy and negotiation and political resolution of conflict. And I think when we don't resource that part of the campaign, when we don't plan for that as the primary objective, that's what we're trying to get to. And suddenly it's upon us and, you know, we don't have the right people, we don't have the research, we don't have the focus, we don't have the plan. I mean, this is a lesson that we need to try to learn as we also, you know, take a greater dose of humility in how we define our objectives in the first place.
From your lips to God's ears, as my other tribe says. So Michèle Flournoy, thank you very much for your service to our country and the world, and for your repeated willingness to subject yourself to be the woman in the arena on my pestering events. So thank you, thank all of you. Thank you, Mary. I am the Mary and David Boies Distinguished Fellow in U.S. Foreign Policy and American at the CFR. And I look forward to seeing all of you who want to at future roundtables.
Great. Thanks so much, everybody.